Hello, this video is going to be getting some code using an LLM and saving it to a file and then executing it. So we'll demonstrate how to generate and execute a Python script dynamically using OpenAI's API. This is my article on my website, redandgreen.co.uk. We'll go through the basics, getting the OpenAI API key set up, or rather accessing it. So if you've got it already via an account, which you will need, you'll just need to use os.getenv. If you haven't got it, you'll get a value error. So if not API key, raise value error. Our imports will be os requests, which will make the request to the OpenAI API, subprocess, which will run our code, and shtill and pathlib, which we'll need for accessing our file. So requesting a script from OpenAI, we'll look at the prompt in a second, but the first thing you want to do is just set up the URL to actually access the OpenAI API. Prompt, we'll need to make this a bit more elaborate in due course, but just to get started, we'll use this. Generate a Python script that fetches the Bitcoin price from Gemini API. That's not Google Gemini, that's it's a crypto exchange. So I just thought we'd use this because it will be live information, it'll be constantly changing. Right, so that's the prompt. So we've got the URL, which is basically a constant. We've got the prompt, which we would request, or it's no pun intended, ultimately we would take that as standard input from the user, so they could either type in a prompt, or even better, we could read it from a file and the user could put their prompt into that file. Also, we could ultimately get the large language model to revise the prompt if it thinks it could come up with something better. Anyway, prompt headers, which is authorization bearer, we're using that as an F string. The API key, which say we'll get from the environment variables, so you should have that either set in a .env file. I set it in my .zshrc file, I'm using Linux. Data, which is model, messages, max tokens. The model, choose what model you want. Messages, you need role, is user, and content will be prompt. Max tokens, you can increase for a better response. The response equals requests, and then you need to post. So you're going to post the URL, you're going to post the headers, and you're going to post the data as JSON. Then the response will be the response.json. And then the script that you want to save to the file will be, you want to get the choices, the zeroth choice, get the message, get the content, otherwise print no response from AI. That is particular to OpenAI's model, but this code could equally apply to anything else, Gemini, DeepSeek, Claude, whatever you want to use. Saving and executing the script, so this is the clever bit, but it's also the dangerous bit, and I would recommend looking at using this within Docker. So you create a Docker file and you want to be putting this script inside Docker as kind of effectively a sandbox. So we're looking at the code on my website, but let's go over to the actual code. So this is the code which we're going to run, same as what you just saw. I've actually embellished the prompt a bit. So generate a Python script that fetches the Bitcoin price from Gemini API. Just give the code. The problem is if you don't tell it to just give the code, it gives you a bit of flowery intro. It sort of said, here's the code, blah, blah, blah. And then in backticks, it gives you the code. So I've said, no small talk, no comments like, here's a simple Python script that imports the request library to send to HTTP requests and fetch the latest Bitcoin price from Gemini API. No backticks either, okay? Just code. And this seems to work because initially when I was testing it, sometimes I was getting backticks and it was given a comment and I was getting an error. And other times it was working. So again, it's non-deterministic, so it means you're not getting the same result every time. But with a bit of a refined prompt, you should get a good result every time. So I found this works. Headers, data, response. The bit that actually saves it to a file is quite interesting. So we use path, and then script.py is the name of a file. And then with open script path, so with open, we're actually opening script.py to write as a file, and then file write script, where script is the JSON response from the large language model. And then we want to just print like a message to the user, Python script generated, then print the script path. To execute it, this is where we use shuttle which. So it's actually detecting whether we've got Python. If we're not, then it will try Python 3. If neither of those are true, then it raises the runtime error. To run the Python script, we do process equals subprocess dot run, and then the Python command, which is either Python or Python 3, and then the string of the script path, capture output true, text equals true. And then if it returns zero, if prints to standard out the output, else it prints an error. So this is kind of the quick and dirty way to do it. I'll show you the way with functions in a minute. I actually used Claude 3.7 Sonnet to help me, or rather just I pasted it in and just said improve this code. What was I going to say? Here we want to just run this and see what it does before we try and refine it. So I've built this project using UV as well, so I did UV init code from LLM. And you can see we've got a script.py, so let's remove that because that's actually what it's generated whilst I've been testing. So I'll just make this a bit bigger as well. All right, Python. I don't think I need to use Python 3. Our aliases are all set up, they're good. So let's just run the main.py. So it's going to go to the LLM, get the code, save the code to file, and then run the file, which is what it's just done. And it's just got the latest BTC price. If I run it again, we might get a different price. Yes, we have, you see. And also, notice how there it did Python script output. It just did that. But a second time, it decided to put this prefix in front. So we are getting a slightly different result depending on each time we run it. And this is what I was trying to show earlier. Sure, here it is. So the third time we run it, we get an error. Obviously, once you've got the script, you've got the script and you're happy with it, then obviously you would just then keep that script. You wouldn't need to keep running this, but if we run it again, yeah, so it's running fine. So out of four attempts, it kind of errored once. So again, you could then ask, or you wouldn't even ask it. You would just then, once you could probably write a test. Once the test was fine, then you would not ever need to run the main.py again. You'd only actually need to be running, you wouldn't run that again because you would know that that always works. And once you've got that, it's good forever. Let's look at the version that Claude created. So if we go across to Claude, if I've got it open. I pasted it in Claude 3.7 Sonnet said, I'll improve your code. Let's just zoom in on that. I'll improve your code by making it more robust. Key improvements: split the code into logical functions, better error handling, timeout handling, better file naming, increased token limit, bumped max tokens to 500 to get more complete scripts, type hints, added Python type annotations for better code clarity, more thorough checking of API responses, clear doc strings for each function, wrap domain logic in a proper main function, if name equals main, better reporting of sub-process errors with exit codes. This version is significantly more robust and will handle various error conditions gracefully instead of crashing. Well, that sounds pretty good. So let's just go and look at main 2, which is the Claude version. So it's putting the doc strings, it's made functions. I actually like this. So well done to Claude. So get the API key, generate the script with OpenAI. So we're passing in the API key and the prompt is strings, and then we get back a string. Notice the increased token, max tokens 500 there. Save the script. So it returns true or false. Run the script. So subprocess.run. And we've put a timeout to prevent it hanging, which is nice. If process return code, so that's kind of similar to what we had before. But notice here it's doing error running Python script Xcode process dot return code. So it's showing you what the error is a bit better. Only ever return pure code, no text before or after, 3 exclamation marks. I don't think I put that in my original prompt. Just give the code so it can be run, no small talk, no comment. Yeah. So that's kind of what I did before. So try, if not return, and then accept an error occurred. Then if name equals main, just to run that. And I think just from memory, I tested this 2 or 3 times and it's definitely more robust. My original version without the functions. So that's different. I had Bitcoin there. Just said script execute successfully. The second time it ran it, it put in the Bitcoin price as a prefix. Third time I ran it, it did a different script without the prefix. Let's run it one more time. So this, I think, so it was only once it decided to put in the prefix. So each time it does it without sort of any prior knowledge. One more time. And you see again, it's decided just this time to prefix it with the Bitcoin price and the dollar sign. So that's the one and only time it decided to put in the dollar sign. But that's run successfully, that's built successfully, that's made a successful script 5 times out of 5. So yeah, Claude 3.7, hats off to you. Just to prove that it's making the script each time, I'll just do this one last time and we'll right, so there's no Python RM. So we've just got our two generate scripts. So if we run, main 2, which is the Claude one. And that's run fine. The non-Claude one, my original script. Yeah, so it just varies each time. It's just, if we look at the actual script, it generates. So this is the one that I first came up with. It just decides to put in the prefix there. So that's the one. If we do Sorry. Let's open the other one. We'll open them side by side. So we'll do that's the yeah, so you just see one's just putting in Bitcoin price, the other one's putting Bitcoin prices with dollars. Other than that, that's identical. If we just go back and actually look at the source code for what we've been doing here, let's look at the main one, which was the one that I actually first came up with. Yeah, I don't know if those exclamation marks made any difference on the end. Let's just up the tokens to 500 as well. Let's just try and run that again. So my original version, let's just see if we can run it four times with four successful results. No. So the Claude version with the functions and more tokens is definitely the better one. So yeah, Claude has beaten me hands down on this because this is a lot more robust and obviously it's got the functions. That price doesn't seem to change. Yes, it did, yeah. So again, you see how if I run it a different time, sometimes it puts in the prefix, other times it doesn't. So it's creating a slightly different script each time, potentially, which is something to watch out for. But yeah, there we go. So just to summarize, what we've done here is we've written some code, which worked. Oh, sometimes it worked. So then we gave it to Claude and we said, improve it. And yeah, Claude made some improvements to it for us. More robust, readable, and adding proper error handling. So a bit of a slap on the wrist from Claude 3.7. there we go. So that was, I've documented the original code here. And yeah, if you want the code from Claude, I can give you it. But yeah. It's just an experiment at this stage, and obviously I would look to run the code in a Docker container because you don't really want LLMs building code and running it on your operating system just willy-nilly, because you could end up with, what if it did rm minus rf star or something from root? You'd be in all kinds of trouble. So, yeah, step two. Build a Docker container or something similar, Podman, or run the code in a sandboxed environment. On that note, thanks for watching. Thumbs up. Hope you liked the video. It's just me experimenting, really. So, take it with a pinch of salt. But hopefully it's given you some inspiration. I just chose, don't hate on the Bitcoin thing. It's just something I knew would have a live API with constantly changing data. So yeah, I mean, you could use weather if you just wanted another one to practice with, a weather API or sports results or whatever. But have fun and see what you can come up with. Thanks for watching.